You said it to me? No, you said we can change the address when we...
That's beautiful. That's a nice looking shirt. Very nice looking shirt. Yeah. Okay. Okay, welcome to the April 19th Board of Selectmen meeting. Hello, everybody. I like doing that. All right, welcome to the April 19th Board of Selectmen meeting. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Any citizens' statements or petitions? Nope. Okay. And I don't think we have any correspondence, Kimberly, do we?
No.
No? Okay, good. So with that, then we'll move right on to the inimitable Mr. Clark Rowell. Can you come join us, please?
Yes.
Yes, please.
And Kristen.
Yep, come, come.
Coming up. Good. A lot of chairs.
Okay. All right, so what was the approach you wanted to take on this, Kimberly?
We're going to go over the information that we had previously received earlier in the week from Clark about the possible funding options, because the entire board had not been walked through it before. So Clark is going to take us through each of the things that are listed before you.
Well, where we left off, if I recall, was we identified one scenario, really, we wanted, if I recall. Or did you end up coming up with more than one?
I sent him with two scenarios. One was if we were able to use CPC funding for the million, and then one for CPC funding if we used 1.4.
Okay, fine. And that's what you've got, those two scenarios?
Uh-huh.
Okay, perfect. I'll turn it over to you to walk us through it, if you could.
Sure. Well, thank you. It's nice to be here. Let me make a couple of real general comments first about what we tried to do with this financing. In general, what we wanted to do is take advantage of other opportunities being created in your debt service structure, debt service falling away, and so on. And we also are trying to take advantage of debt service if in the future falls away and rapid debt around it. We are trying, to the extent possible, to keep a very level tax rate impact, so whatever the impact is, it is there for the duration, the tax rate does not jump around. And finally, we are tried to make this as short of financing as possible, so there'd be another financing opportunity for you in a reasonable future, so you're not looking at a 30-year bond issue. So on Monday, I distributed some numbers, and let me just walk you through those quickly. Feel free to stop me if you have questions, because some of this may be a little new. Or at least how I present it might be a little new. And the first page is very simple. This is your current excluded debt service as of June 30th, 2017. And that means basically it includes your 2007 bonds, it includes your 2012 bonds, and it also includes a very small serial loan you did for the library, a little three-year loan. But in essence, this is inclusive of all your excluded debt service. What you see here also is after the school district assessment, the last big school district assessment is 2017, has fallen away. So here you see what would it be after that. The second page is a little corollary opportunity, one that's not directly related to the police station, but one that we ought to consider and frankly, which I think we ought to take advantage of. Your 2007 bonds can now be refunded. It's not a lot of refunding, but it is a very legitimate opportunity. It will save a little money, and any time we say little money is better than no money, it's probably something we ought to do.
Yeah, please define refunded.
Refund those bonds, yes.
Yeah, define refunded.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. The old bonds are at a relatively high interest rate. You, in effect, issue new bonds at a lower interest rate and replace those old bonds with these new bonds.
Okay, so when you say refunded, it's the same, really, essentially, as refinance.
Yes. Yeah. Refunding is more of a public finance term. Refinance is more of a homeowner's term, let's say.
Understood.
But it's essentially the same thing.
Just wanted to make sure the people at home understood if they were listening.
And just to be thorough, the old bonds have a redemption date, a date which they can be called and replaced with other bonds. That's what we're looking at. On that date, we'll take those old bonds out, we'll pay them off with the proceeds of the new bonds, and you'll have the remainder of that issue except at a lower interest rate, and you'll save some money. The savings are shown on this page. It's not a lot, but it has the quality of use it or lose it. It is, without getting too technical, but towards the bottom of the page, you see these percent figures of present value savings without explaining what those are, because we'll get technical fast. Mm-hmm. But at least in the business, those are very appropriate savings. When somebody sees a refunding like that, they say it's warranted, let's do it. And that's our suggestion, let's do that. We did talk about combining the two issues if the police station were to go ahead, but I think it's more advantageous to do this now while interest rates are attractive, grab the savings and just have it part of your foundation of excluded debt service upon which you put this police station.
Okay, so I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, it's okay. So, Clark, this is the first time I've really taken a good solid look at this document.
Uh-huh.
So forgive me if I'm asking stupid questions here. So when I look at the value benefit, I don't want to get too technical on this. I see a value benefit if we were to refund at $135,225. Is that a total value benefit or is that an annual benefit?
The $135,000 figure is a present value measure. The figure up above the savings column, that's your budgetary savings. That's what you'll actually
be. $3,700.
I'm sorry?
$3,798.
The $146,400.
$146,000.
Annual. That's what you'll save over time. That's the amount you don't have to appropriate over time. The $135,000 figure is, well, what's the present value? Money on the table, what's it mean now?
Okay.
So it is a little less because the easily said time comes value of money, a little more difficult to explain. But
so basically $146,000 over a 10-year span,
yes,
is what you said.
Okay. Yep.
All right.
And these ought to be conservative numbers. I think we can do better than this, but when you're talking about a refunding, it'll rather be conservative, so between now and then, when you actually get to it, if rates go up, you still have a viable refunding. But so this isn't a lot, it's about a penny and a half on the tax rate, but again, it's better, why not? And I hope to do better.
Okay, so just to make sure it's clear to everyone, and myself as well, so what you just said there was that what you showed us would be having two bonds, not one, right?
Correct.
One to refinance the existing debt and get some savings, and a second one to do the police station. Instead of combining them because we want to get the impact of the savings as soon as possible.
Correct.
Okay, all right, just want to make sure that was clear.
Yeah.
Okay.
The third page is what we call the sources and uses of funds. This presents the first issue. It's for a $4,985,000 bond. It assumes that $1 million will be funded with CPA supported revenues and the balance $3,985,000 supported by the tax levy. That would be the part that we're going to be most focusing on. This is a somewhat technical page, but it's helpful for someone like me because I can see all the potential uses of the funds are covered. That is, we've got a fully funded project, plus I can see, we're properly paying the underwriter, we're properly paying issuance costs. So this represents the financing and all the different pieces of it. The next page shows the aggregate debt service of this issue. The two separate pieces you'll see on the left, the levy supported, that's the $3,985,000, and to the right, the CPA supported $70,000 a year approximately. If you look at the levy piece, that's where you're going to see the first time you're going to see some numbers that are kind of strange. And actually, let me look at the CPA piece first. There, in essence, what we've done is assume if there's $1 million of support, it will be paid in 20 years, over 20 years, in level debt service, equal annual payments of principal and interest, approximately $70,000, $72,000 a year. This is comfortably under what they have available under the tax, under the general laws that, where it allows them to authorize debt. That is, general laws makes the test. If you're going to support a bond issue with CPA funds, you've got to show you've got enough surcharge. This figure is comfortably under what that figure would be. So we're okay there. The levy piece is the interesting piece, though. There you can see the debt service is doing something rather strange. It's increasing a bit until you get about 10 years out, and then it increases dramatically and then falls off in 2031. It falls off rather dramatically and runs out another approximately 10 years. This is the effect of wrapping the police station debt around your existing debt. We basically are filling up your debt, always keeping a nice level impact on the tax rate, but as other debt falls away, we're taking advantage of that. For example, your current outside the levy limit debt service is about $534,000. In 2 years, it drops to $484,000. We're going to fill that up with debt service from this school. And then you can even see the biggest advantage in 2027, you've got the drop off of your 2007 bonds, and then you see debt service drop, or levy supported portion of the debt service pick up significantly. Again, we're filling up that gap. Until we get to the point that we can have a very significant drop in debt service and just run out relatively small amounts thereafter. And if you were look at this, what you basically see is in that this looks like you've got 13 years of increasing payments, then that significant drop off, and the issue goes down to 22 years total. And on the next page, you see why we did it this way. Here you have all your excluded debt service, including the police station, with where there's $1 million of CPA funding supporting the cost of the police station. The far right, you can see we've got approximately $685,000 of total excluded debt service. That's up from the $534,000. And what we have done as we've progressively put in more principal on the police station, on the levy supported portion of the police station, is keep that $684,000, $685,000, $686,000 about the same until you get out to 2030, and then in 2031 it drops away, and such a significant drop, it gives you almost a $500,000 opportunity to take on the next major capital project if you choose to do so. The page six is just the second option that we were asked to do. Essentially the same concept, except this time the CPA support portion of the issue is $1.4 million. Again, you have the sources and uses of funds. This is a properly funded project. All the costs are met. On page seven, you can see the two pieces again. This time the CPA on the left, and you can see at $1.4 million, their cost has jumped up to about $100,000 per year. But equal annual payments approximately to the extent we can for 20 years. The levy supported portion of the police station again shows that odd effect of the debt service building until 2030, when there is the end of that build up. 2031, a significant drop. And finally, in the last page, the consolidated debt service. This time, rather than up to $685,000, it's up to $666,000, and it runs out the same amount of time until 2030. The last year, about $668,000. Then it drops to $133,000, or $530,000 drop, the chance for the next capital project. And if you look at this, in essence, that's only 13 years away. Yes, this is a 22-year issue, but for practical purposes, at least from my perspective, you see it as a 13-year issue. You have a level impact, and then boom, there's your chance for the next project, because that the residual debt service is a relatively small amount, and what you'll really be thinking about is that next project that you might fit in there if you so choose. And I think that's, you either all understand it very well or you're confused.
I'm going to just restate the essential elements that you said in much plainer language, just to make sure it's crystal clear. And frankly, I think what you've done here, and I told you the other day, Clark, I think is bloody brilliant. I think if we're going to do a debt exclusion for this, which I'm still not sure I 100% support, but if we're going to do it, this is the way to do it. And the reason is exactly as Clark had laid out. Number one, we have the school debt dropping off, and then when that drops off, we would take some of that drop off to put back the amount we need for the police station. That the way it would be financed would be in such a way to even the tax rate without spikes dropping and going up and down. It would stay essentially level till 2030, and in 2030 we know that we've got the ability, when another bigger drop than we just are going to have happens, to do the next capital project, which you know will occur, and maybe even before the 13 years. So I think the way you've laid this out, and then to include, because we don't know yet whether or not how much we're going to be able to use CPA for. So I clearly understand that we had to run both scenarios with and without CPA. Makes complete sense.
And what was the impact to the taxpayers at the tax rate by doing this? With full debt exclusion, that's keeping the tax rate flat, the way that I understand it, correct?
Right now, we believe from the calculations we've done that actually, having done all of that, the taxpayers would actually see a flat tax rate from this year to next year, which that's not normal all by itself,
right?
Much less to squeeze in a police station.
Right, exactly. Okay, which is what we've been
right
promoting.
If we're gonna do it, there's no better approach than this and now.
That's right.
Mrs. Mazar.
I would just have a request if CPA funds are used to do the same thing where for 5 years, more years, we have to pay off the FINO debt, so balance that out, so it's not even for all years, but we're paying less at the beginning, and then, you know, more later on, just so that what CPA is paying is more consistent. Do you know what I'm saying?
The CPA portion is intended to be consistent level payments, because we figure the CPA is probably least able to allow the debt service to jump around.
Right, but for 5 more years, we have like $100,000 payments to make. Oh, I'm sorry. You know?
Yeah.
And so I'd rather kind of keep it at like that $100,000 for the whole time, so that we're not paying like $170,000 for the first.
Yeah, can you balloon it after 5 years, is what she's saying? Because that would give them a chance to finish FINO and then stay smoother, just like we're doing with the
but
the
it'll be, so it'll be the opposite of how you've got the town side structured now, where you've got a higher payment structured, where in 2030 it drops.
Mm-hmm.
I think, Ann, what you're asking is to do the opposite, where it's a lower payment for the first few years until the FINO debt drops off. Because you have the same scenario then with the FINO debt for the CPA that we have right now with the school. So you structure it so that you have an even payment. Mm-hmm. So it's lower up front, and then it goes up 5 years into the term. Is that what you're asking?
I'm thinking, just on your turn. Yeah, I'm not sure why we couldn't do that. Yeah. Let me make a general statement, and I don't mean to upset you with this one, but just so you know, when financings are done, they're done by the Treasurer, the approval of the Selectmen. So ultimately, how the structure is done will be sort of done by this group. But I think what you're asking is a reasonable request, and I'm not sure we couldn't accommodate it. And I think we could accommodate it, frankly, either way. That is, if you wanted a smaller payment and then take advantage of the fall away of the FINO, or you might say, no, leave it at this payment and accelerate our police station portion, so we have a big drop off like in the year 13 like you do. Again, I'll defer to the town exactly as to what they'd like to do, but it certainly that seems like a reasonable request on either way, depending on what you like.
Yeah, and I don't know, from my perspective, I think that if that's what you want to do, I think I would support that. It's fine with me. talk through.
I think it'd be good, I mean, to see what the impact is.
Yeah.
You know, see what the, you know, what the dramatic impact on paying the police station down would be by taking that same approach with the CPA.
If we do what she's requested, it's really not going to have a whole lot of impact on anything else here. It's just going to mean they will have more resources available to them.
That's what she's asking.
For a bunch of years.
That's what she wants.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
So perhaps then, Clark, if you don't mind, maybe you could put together a sheet similar to this for those two pieces so that we can, she can see what those would look like and bring it back to the CPC committee.
Sure.
Why don't we wait until we know more definitively what the amount from CPA is going to be?
Well, that's a good point, too, yeah, because we could spend a lot of time
right.
on something that's not going to happen. So let's wait till that, yeah. That makes sense? Yeah, okay. Thank you.
This is great.
Okay, any further questions on that?
Okay, good.
We've got a lot of finance guys out in the audience. I'm surprised nobody's got any questions. Okay.
I think this is a great strategy.
Yeah.
I think you did a fantastic job, Clark.
Well, thank you, but you know, you should get credit too. You're the one that said, you have these nice drop-offs set up that way.
we could take credit for those, but those were prior boards.
Yeah,
so.
That's right, yeah.
It's always distressing for someone like me when I see a town that does maybe a project every couple of years and they just layer on more and more debt service. So you have this little dribbling off debt service. Distinct drops are helpful when yeah. you know, and you do know, there's going to be time for another capital project.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, good. All right, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Police station.
Yeah, we don't have time though, because he's got the.
You know what?
I'm looking. More for a quorum, and I've only got the only two.
There's one.
Now you get one, yeah. Okay, so you need one more?
Right. We have to have a public hearing on the budget.
No, understood, but it can't start early, but it could start a little bit later.
Yes.
He doesn't have a quorum.
No, I understand. I'm just stating a fact.
Don, how much time do you think we'll need to review your? Okay, that's what I thought you'd say. Okay, maybe we.
we can do.
I don't want to shortcut it.
Right, we might as well just adjourn to attend their meeting and then wait to see if they have a quorum. I mean, I assume they're going to, right?
Yeah, right.
Six minutes.
Okay.
And then that'll give them. They can come
on.
We can sit down.
Mike, are we gonna broadcast your hearing as well? So we might as well just, yeah.
Yes. Okay.
All right. All right, we're going to take a break then while the Finance Committee waits for the quorum for 7 o'clock for the hearing. And then Joe will pick up after the public hearing, okay? Yeah, they did a really good job. Welcome, everyone. This is the Finance Committee's budget hearing for the fiscal year 2018 budget. We've spent the last several months vetting this budget, and we'll be recommending these numbers at the annual town meeting next month. But what I wanted to do is go through those numbers. I have copies. Anybody would like a copy of the budget? I do. Yes. Especially if you're the moderator.
I was thinking more of the school guys.
So you mean the school guy does?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're gonna, this is kind of a dry run for the annual town meeting. What we normally do is if you look at the budget, for those who have a copy in your hand, we have department numbers, and I go through the subtotals for each of the department numbers. If there's any particular questions at ATM or your annual town meeting, you want to stop it. You know, the moderator will explain that at that point, but right now what I'm going to just go through the numbers of the detailed budget by department. So I'm gonna start and try to get through this reasonably quickly without losing people. But so if we start in the heading of general government, actually the moderator's salary zeroed out. That would be 114. So if we move on to Department 122, the FY subtotal for the selectmen is $52,332. For the Finance Committee Department. You know, I can put the cap on this, or I just, yeah, right. I'm going to rule you out of order, sir.
The first time, will
no comment. 131 Finance Committee, $74,000. 135 Town Accountant, $46,681. 141 Board of Assessors, $92,467.
Mike?
Yes?
I got $93,467.
Hang on. So this number may not be. Do you have any of those left over?
Do we have any leftover budget sheets that would be passed around?
Yeah, I already have mine.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I get this electronically tomorrow?
Yes.
Thank you.
I'm on it.
We're gonna go by the. These are the correct numbers. So again, 141 Board of Assessors, $92,467. Department 145 Town Treasurer Collector, $138,347. 151 Town Council, $80,000. Department 161 Town Clerk, $56,868. Elections and Registration, Department 162, $10,304. Engineering Consulting Services, 165, $4,000. Department 171, Conservation, $15,434. Department 175, Planning Board, $33,678. 176 Zoning Board, $3,827. 179 Land Use Committee, $550. Department 195 Town Reports, $2,250. 199 Town Hall Services, $519,451. Total for General Government, $1,100,189. Now if we move on to public safety, because we don't have a public safety director, the budget for Department 200 is zero. Police Department, Department number 210 is $1,476,803. Department 220, Fire Department, $732,572. Inspectional Services Department 241 is $61,991. Department 242, the gas inspector, $5,300. Department 243, plumbing inspector, $4,250. Department 244, sealer of weights and measures, $1,500. Department 245, electrical inspector, $14,525. Department 291, emergency management, $4,650. Department 292, dog officer, $16,080. Department 294, tree warden, $42,534. Dispatching, which is Department 299, $232,364. Total public safety, $2,592,569. Now we go on to the schools. Department 301, which is the Mendon Upton Regional School District. Total for Mendon's share of that is $9,288,447. Department 310, Blackstone Valley Vocational School. Total is $1,085,625. Total for the schools is $10,374,072. Public Works, Department 421, Road Machinery, $65,498. Department 422, Highway Construction and Maintenance, $536,215. Department 423, snow and ice removal, $159,000. Department 424, streetlights, $19,500. Department 450, water department, $170,600. 491, soldiers and sailors' graves, $100. Department 510, public welfare, the Board of Health, $439,400. Department 541, Council on Aging, $112,930. Department 543, Veterans Benefits, $38,800. Total Public Welfare, $591,130. Department 610, the Library, $256,023. Department 630, Parks and Recreation, $94,812. Department 691, Historical Commission, $250. Department 692, Special Events, $400. Total for Culture and Recreation, $351,485. Now, to go through debt service now, which certainly expenses we have to pay, but isn't really part of the yearly budget as far as how much we spend. But retirement of debt principal, Department 710 is $459,000. Interest on long-term debt, $751,000, total of $136,031. Then we have interest on short-term debt. There is none for that department. So total debt service, $595,031. And then we have departments 911 for Worcester County Retirement for employee benefits, $519,386. Workers' compensation insurance, $23,750. Department 913, $500 for unemployment insurance. Total health insurance for the town of Mendon, Department 914 this year, $826,264. Department 916, long-term disability insurance, $12,950. 916, which is Medicare, expenses $50,000. Department 919, police and fire accident insurance, $20,235. Department 945, property and casualty insurance, $84,096. The total of those miscellaneous areas, $1,537,181. We also have special articles and other expenses, which we go through each year. Everything cyclical inspection program, update valuation, assessor appellate tax, police matching grants. And this year, we have a line here for the 350th celebration.
Those totals are $58,500. The assessor's overlay expense, $120. Total for other expenses, $133,856. Total of special articles and other expenses, $192,356. At the end of the bottom line, the total budget, $18,284,926. And that is the... That's the total. That's the hearing for this year's budget. Any questions?
Can you do that fast at the town meeting?
Certainly going to try, sir. As long as we can get the chairman of the Board of Selectmen not to put any holds on it like he did tonight.
I never recognized him, so...
Well, yeah, but he is recognizable, though. Yes. All right, then at this point, we're going to adjourn our meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.
That was pretty fast. Easy peasy.
What's that?
Good. Nice work.
Thank you.
See you all, Mike, on the 5th.
Yeah, right. Cinco de Mayo.
Next week. I have nothing. I don't even have a spreadsheet.
What's this?
That's from reading.
Okay.
Really quickly before we go, Ms. Davern just brought up a point. We need to put the, we got to have the FinCom book together.
Right. We're already on that.
You are?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right, you heard it first.
Okay.
What the cutoff date you need to buy to get it printed is when?
I think I told Kim already.
Oh, okay.
Right. So
okay,
it's already good. Been proofed.
All
it's
right.
Ready to go after tonight. It goes forward tomorrow with the numbers that were from the hearing tonight, and they'll get published.
Okay. Then I mind my own business.
No, that's quite all right, sir.
It's hard for me to do, but I will mind my own business. Okay. All right.
Ready?
Now, on to the building committee. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
All right, so you guys have a little PowerPoint for us. You want to just dive right into that, or?
I think the easiest way is dive right into it. They did a fabulous job putting this together, kind of a chronological order of what the committee has done since they were appointed last summer, bringing us to where we are today. So the first slide gives you the background when the board elected to...
Joe, could you bring that a little closer?
Again, thank you. When the board elected to appoint the committee and then gave us our charter back in last fall of what to do, what to look at for the police station, the different options you asked us to explore. Building committee members. The next five slides are all pictures of the current station. These will probably be beneficial for you for the town meeting presentation. Chief Kersey might want to run through these a little bit for us and explain some of the deficiencies that are out there.
Yeah, I think these photographs are important, and I'd like to see this deck up on our website so residents can take a look at some of these pictures so they see some of this, but go ahead.
Don usually posts it right after the week, so that'll be a lot there. You want to go over all the pictures now, or?
Say again?
You want to go over all the pictures now, or?
Well, I just think some commentary on what we're looking at might be helpful.
Okay. Maybe some of the more glaring things, or?
Yeah.
Yeah, so let's go, we look at the bottom three. Obviously, the top three are just the station, the land that we have out back that we don't utilize currently. Probably about a third of this lot is just empty, and there's no way to get to it because it's behind the police station, you know, a secure area. So we really don't utilize the lot as much as we should. The bottom three are, you know, confined spaces. So you're looking at the left picture. That's a conference room, a break room, a server room, an interview room. And you can see by the half wall there, it's not closed at all. It was built afterwards, so it's really not a private interview room or a conference room or anything. It's just kind of a extra room that we built a wall up around. The booking room, that's it. That's a whole entire booking room. They come into.
Sorry, Chief. Which one's the booking room?
The next picture over the right.
The middle bottom.
The middle bottom. That's a booking area. Pretty much some 1990 cabinets that we put together and put a countertop on with an old bench.
Perfect.
Go over there and use a laser pointer.
Yeah. Does that microphone work up there?
I'll talk loud. Use the page.
I don't.
No. There you go.
That's the problem.
Use that one.
So right here, that's our whole booking area. We basically just have a counter here. This bar is kind of screwed into the wall, as safe as it can be if we actually had to use it. We had something violent. Obviously, it's not handicap accessible. We make do with what we have. The door is nice. The area all around here isn't appropriate for it. Safety-wise, it's better than what we had before. We had a desk in there, so we built this ourselves. Probably about 10, 15 years ago. Then dispatch here. Dispatch actually isn't too bad of a size right now. We did the best we could with a grant. We have about 200,000. We were able to get all the equipment. So we put a lot of new equipment in here that can be transferred to the new station eventually if we get one. But it's still the same area. Right here, you can almost see that's a beam. This whole part of dispatch actually used to be the lobby. And we ran out of space, so we took down the exterior lobby wall. And we built out into the lobby because we gave the space to dispatch. Next slide.
So, no, Chief, before you do, if you could back up. So help us understand, because obviously what we're looking to build, and I'm sure you guys will get into this in a little bit, we're not looking to build anything grandiose by any means, right? And so if we were looking at kind of a middle-of-the-road, you know, usual and customary booking room, what would be different from what we're seeing there? Just so the people, anybody watching, would understand what that's missing.
And then we can go over to the plans. There's separate detention areas. So you go into certain areas, you get into a certain area, it's a detention area where you can make everybody safe. Put your guns away, leave them cuffed. It's kind of like almost like if you look at decontamination when something happens, you go in that first realm. You want to get your guns safe, you want to make sure they're safe again, have them again. So that's your first area to make sure that everything is safe for everybody. Then you go into another area that's separate from that area, and that would be a contained area where you can have a different type of bench set up, leg irons if you need it, proper irons on the side if you had to handcuff someone it was out of control. You had to come to the wall, leg irons down there. You would have some type of protective barrier here. So I think in the diagram it shows is a, you can go back, you want to just
That's okay. I didn't want to jump forward.
Once we get to it, I'll show you the whole thing.
That's fine.
and to be clear, what we have currently does not meet the current DPH standards.
No. Cell-wise, we're being localized. We failed it the past 1 year. Since I've been a police officer, yeah, we've passed it.
Okay.
We have not passed.
We have not passed.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
So this is... this is what we use for storage up here. We have a file room. This is our file room. We are using currently the upstairs of the police station. It really shouldn't be, but we have no other space to use. You can clearly see here, this is what we brought up here to the wet architect. When they built the second floor, they kind of just tore the old roof off and built another floor on it. So it's just there. And they told us it's not rated for any type of loads. We really shouldn't have too much up there. Storage-wise, they weren't going to stop us from using it. We have nowhere else to put this stuff. the excess storage that we've made in the peak. So even right here, you see the little plumbing from the way it was before, they kind of just, this is the old joists from where the roof was. They just basically cut it all off, put another floor on top of it, and then built up from it.
Mm.
So that's been an issue since the day they've been in there. And then, now again, we can kind of see, Linda took some pretty pictures. This is the evidence, not the evidence room, the records room. So we have to keep everything chronological. The history of mental police is in there, file cabinets. Right now, we're lucky we can put stuff on data. But this stuff we have to keep forever. This is old records, only back the chief and talking.
Is that file cabinets behind that grate? That
fencing?
There we go. That work?
That's good, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
So up here, yeah, there's all file cabinets down that way, this way. We have to keep them secured, so we had actually Alan help us out. Alan built this for us, a secure room for all our records. Behind there, you have to go through the records room to get the armory. The armory is another room that was built by Alan. And then we have another room to the side that I built for the explorers and other additional equipment. To the other side of this, Linda didn't take a picture. We have right here, the other side is our evidence room. Again, something that myself and another officer just built with 2x4s and plywood. But that's where all our evidence is. This is our cellar area that we used to have for storage, but it's become unusable. It floods every spring, every fall. There's oil tanks down there that are of concern. The cement here, you can see, is literally, I had Linda take these pictures, falling apart. You touch it, the cement block just deteriorates. She had some of the piles here, you can't see them as well, but that's just piles of cement just from the water coming in that is just, the foundation is just breaking apart. And I don't think there's anything you can do to restore it because it's all the way through. It's just always wet in there. There is no drainage. There is mold. We do have a mold issue down there. That's why we don't allow anybody down there. I don't think Linda got those. Did you get those pictures, Linda?
The mold is on the next
slide. The next slide. So we can go to the next slide. This is why we stopped everybody using that. We used to store at least some stuff down there, but the stairs started rotting out and it became a mold issue. So we pretty much condemned the downstairs and we don't allow anybody to go down there anymore. This is the only entrance we have for officers. They pretty much come down a small narrow hallway that we built. This used to be booking and an entrance. The state told us we couldn't allow that anymore. We had this built. We hired a local contractor, just put a wall right in between the current room, just so at least we would have some type of distance between where the cells are and where there's another exit. So we were non-compliant for 20 years with that, and they said either you do something about it or we're just gonna shut you down until we built that. So you walk in, you walk by the two bathrooms. These are the bathrooms here. They just have been falling apart. They're 25 years old. We don't wanna put any more money into them. They weren't that great to begin with. The cell areas here, we have two cells. They both look similar to this. One of the cells in the rear left corner that goes to the outside, we had to have repaired a while ago. We noticed because we saw our prisoners messing around with the cell, and then when we noticed what he was doing after, it was actually a hole. So he was poking to the outside through the concrete blocks. We did have that repaired, but
El Chapo.
Yeah, so we had that repaired. This is what we have to secure the cells right now. This is part of the reason, one of the many reasons we're not up to code. Literally, this is brand new. We had a local contractor fix it. We had someone combative in here a couple months ago, and he literally kicked the door off the hinges and this off of the wall. So we had to switch him to a cell, close this cell down for about a week, and have a contractor come in to fix it right away. Luckily, we charged him. He paid for the damage, and we do have the money to get a new door, but there's no way to make these doors compliant the way they are right now.
Chief, talk a little bit about the challenge with only having two cells and the juvenile and female prisoners.
Yeah, but I guess the challenge isn't, we could have three cells. The challenge isn't two cells, it's two cells that aren't divided, and there's no way to divide them. So What they do now is pretty creative. Instead of having cell block areas for females, juveniles, males, you'll see what the architect did in this one is they have complete sound and sight closed cells. So the cell will come out, we don't have any pictures here. So this cell, say we had one at the new station, there would be another door outside that would make this sight and sound separate. So you literally could put three together and you can house females, a female, a male, and a juvenile and not be in violation of the law whatsoever. So right here we can't because there's no way to separate them.
Right, so that's costing us overtime, et cetera, et cetera.
If we have a female, it doesn't cost us anything. If we have a male, it doesn't cost us anything. It's when we have both or when we have a juvenile. It will cost us overtime to bring them somewhere else and have them watched at another station. We've had to do that for 20 years. There's no way of getting around that.
It's quite a bit of money also.
Yeah, we're paying that, but it's still cheaper than if we were to have two people in there and we violated the law by doing that, they could sue the town.
Yeah.
You know, so, and it they win. There's no argument for that, you know? So.
Okay.
This is the conditions of the outside. We've had this oil tank here that we've tried to fix, but we would literally have to, the work to fix this is enormous. I mean, the monetary value to fix, we just couldn't even, it wouldn't even make sense to try to do this. This is underneath the cells right now. So this is the corner of the building in the back. There's a cell here and there's a cell there.
Those
and that's
pipes
where
going into
oil
the ground?
Tanks come in and the oil tanks are, yeah, they've leaked throughout the years. We fixed what we could, but the damage is already done.
They look like they're going into the ground.
Yeah, I don't think
they kind of do.
The tanks are down below in the basement.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's not going through a sill. It looks like it's going through the block foundation as well.
Yeah, that's
like.
Exactly where it's going through.
Wow.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay. So. I've never been back there. That's interesting. Yeah.
These are the confined spaces. So this is our new lobby right here, which is just a small space that used to be an entryway. So we turned the entryway into a lobby. We had no choice. So there is nowhere to have any private conversations, nowhere to be able to come in and feel safe in that area. We had to tear out the rugs. We tried putting a rug in, but the way the grade is here and the way that this was built, it always floods. And the water actually goes into dispatch every now and then. So we have carpets in there and they get soaked when they go through there. This right here is one small room. It's probably 10 by 10 maybe. But this room is our data room, our server room, our communications room for all our radios here. It's a dispatch break room. It's a dispatch locker room. And it's the evidence for the video systems right here and the entry to get upstairs into the attic. So we may do with what we have, but everything is pretty much there. That's in the new station, that probably should be, I think we looked at 12 or 1500 square feet. It's right now it's in about 150 square feet, you know? So it's one tenth of the size it should be. But I mean, it's not really, it's a hazard in itself. 911 barely lets us keep the equipment here. That's a secure tray they have there that they allow to stay in there, but they weren't happy about it, but we have nowhere else to put it. And we do run a regional dispatch, so we do need this equipment. There's no getting around it. We have to have that equipment. Is that it? Okay.
Chief, thank you very much. You did a much better job than I could with that.
If we get the booking, I can show you.
I think it's important to note, too, because I have heard feedback from residents who express frustration over, you know, what is perceived as lack of maintenance at the police station. But this stuff far exceeds issues with maintenance. I mean, we're to the point where we're basically throwing good money after bad in this building.
I mean, that building is approaching 30 years of use, just as the police station at this point in time, so...
Yeah, I mean, in 1997, I mean, so maintenance, yeah, you're right, we haven't sunk more money into it, but in 97, when I was here, a lot of that room was, that conference room was also a locker room for the police officers, it was an office, it was in bad shape then. So, I mean, maintenance-wise, there was really nothing to maintain. You already had something in bad shape. I mean, I don't know how you maintain something that's already in bad shape. And it was done with, that was a highway barn that was, I mean, Mike probably knows $100,000 was put into a highway barn to make a police station. So we never really had a police station. Menden's never had a police station. We've been in the cellar here long before myself, and then we went into a highway barn.
Okay.
So moving on, at the request of the Board of Selectmen, they asked us to look at, you know, whatever sites in town there were. We identified 8 different sites, and going through a series of, you know, what worked, what didn't work, we reduced that list down to 3 sites, Morrison Drive, that we know about, and then 2 options for the Town Hall complex here, the former fire station and a new building on the Town Hall complex. And then in December, we were given funding from the Board of Selectmen so that we could hire an architect. We hired the architect who had done the Bellingham Police Station. We had met with him. We had gone over and toured the Bellingham Police Station, and we're very impressed with the work that they had done over there. So we got the funding for that. We met with the architect. The chief has spent quite a bit of time with him, going over all the space requirements and whatnot. It was actually a very informative process for us. And after meeting with them, we narrowed it down to 2 options, Morrison Drive still in the picture and the former fire station. The building, a new building on Town Hall complex, just wasn't feasible. There's a photo taken last week by Linda, and that's what Morrison Drive looks like currently at this point in time. Yeah, and this is the architect's rendering for a conceptual design for what the fire station building would look like from the street facing into it. The next one would be a side view of the same thing. Again, this is his rendering. This is a design concept. This is not an actual design. If the project gets approved, we would hire an architect who would actually do the real design for the project. But this gives everybody an idea. So the cost estimates, we had the cost estimate that was done by the Correll Group for the Morrison Drive property, and that's been added on for inflation since 2015 when that was completed. And the range on that is $3.6 to $3.85 million for a 6,700 square foot building. And Casel Booz, the architect who did the conceptual design for the former fire station here, this came in at $4.99 million for a 9,200 square foot building. We'd like to point out that the 9,200 square foot building is a downsized building. One of the things that they did with the chief was go through all of his space requirements and looking at the future, and they were up 10,500 square feet or so.
Yeah, I think it was almost 11,000. So
the chief worked with them, and they reduced the size of that by close to 2,000 square feet to get the cost down on that as well. The pros of the Morrison Drive location, obviously less expensive than the former fire station, not too far from the geographical center of Mendon. I know that's very important to the chief. One thing that he wants to work on is community policing, and that's a big part of that. It's close to the Mendon Fire Station, the senior center of the Highway Department. You could leverage the proximity to the fire station for joint public safety, which was the original intent back a number of years ago when the fire station was built down there. And it would allow the former fire station, I know there's been some talk about using that for municipal space. And it would also finish a project that was started by the Friends of the Mendon Police. The cons for the Morrison Drive location is it's too small based on the space requirements that were done with the architect. It lacks expansion capability. It's off the main road. I know that's an issue with the fire department down there. They feel that nobody knows where they are down there, and it would be exacerbating the problem with the police station down there too. There's no means of secondary egress from the property. One of the points of concern that the chief had is there's only that narrow passageway over the wetlands there to get to that site there. So if something ever happened there and blocked that off, the police wouldn't be able to get out of the property there. Morrison Drive doesn't have any lighting on the main road coming in. We've talked about that. The Sallyport, the original building there, my belief is that the ambulance that was in use at that point in time was smaller than the one that is used today, so the current ambulance will not fit in the Sallyport. So that would have to be retrofitted.
I didn't know about that.
And then the front entrance is too narrow for all access into it.
Just a quick question, Chief. What did the I know that we're talking about 9,700 square feet here, as opposed to 62 over there, right? But what was the recommendation if we could have the size that the that the architect really recommends for our size municipality?
It was what the chairman said, it was close to 11,000.
I think it was close to 11,000.
I missed that.
So it was close to 11,000.
It was close to 11,000.
With expansion.
This building here is 9,200, Morrison is 6,700.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
What we did is we literally, we were in my office going through this several times, and when we looked at the plans, you know, we started with my office, I was in my office, and he had an office on, and it was 260 square feet, and I literally pulled a tape measure out and said, "Let's something my office is now, it's 150. Okay, let's make that 150. Let's go to the next office," and we did that. We started making the office space smaller first, and then we cut a cell out. We had four cells, we went down to three, because we looked back at our, you know, our call volume and how much arrest we really have. Could we make do with three? So we cut that down. You know, we cut down a two-day Sallyport, a one-day Sallyport, you know, because him and I had talked about it, but he never put in the plans, you know, that would have made him bigger. So we literally went through every point in there and got to a point where we cut it down to 92, and then we almost wanted to cut it down a little bit more, and then we just stopped, because he said, "I'm not comfortable cutting it down anymore," and putting my name on it.
Yeah.
So.
You get to a point of diminishing return with that, too.
Yeah.
Don, can we go? Thank you. Pros of the former fire station, large enough to meet current needs along with additional future expansion space. It'll repurpose a historic building. It's in the center of downtown, good for community policing. The site work and existing building renovation, as our understanding, would be eligible for CPA funding. We could also work with, there's been discussions with Blackstone Valley about having them do the build-out on the second floor. Again, it would delay that a little bit, but there'd be more cost savings with that as well. We would have to pay for materials, but we'd save on the labor cost of things there. And the cons, it's, obviously, it's a larger building, so it's gonna be more expensive than Morrison Drive. We would need to obtain an easement from the neighbor for a second egress there. I know that the chief has been talking to the neighbor about that.
Yeah, I've given these plans to the neighbor. He's given everything to his lawyers. He and his sister don't wanna see the police station go anywhere else and wanna work with us to make sure we have an easement there. So it's, I guess, seeing where we go from here. If the building passes, then he's on board with us. You know, the only thing he asks is that, you know, take as little as you can for the easement. Instead of doing, I think there was a 40-foot section that the architect wanted to do, we said we'll keep the less than 25 and build a retaining wall and do most of the work from our side, so we don't tear up his fields.
Which is certainly reasonable.
Yeah, more than reasonable.
Let's see, former fire station will no longer be available for potential future municipal use, so that's something to be considered. And then, once the station is built, the lower level of town hall would be given back to the municipal employees to be turned back into town hall space again.
So, before you continue, I just wanted to make a quick point, because I was doing some calculations while you were talking. But on the con about this being, potentially being a little more, actually, per square foot, it's a lot cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
With CPA, right?
Yes.
So we build out Morrison Drive, it essentially is gonna cost us $574 per square foot to build, where here it'll cost us $434 per square foot.
Yeah. And then, we did have the note at the bottom there, in case, you know, some people still don't know, I guess, but we are occupying pretty much two-thirds of the cellar right now. So we started here, and we're back down there. We have our locker rooms down there. The squad room is down in the lower town hall. The sergeant's office is in the lower town hall. So we currently occupy a good portion of this town hall, too.
In previous to that, right, how many years in the trailers?
Yeah, we're in the trailers that we just...
That were adjacent to the fire station that cost the town.
So, I mean, people have seen the trailers are gone. We took them out in August, but that space still had to go somewhere, so now it's just occupying something you don't see, the whole lower town hall, which will be no longer in use.
So, cost comparison, the former fire station would be $4.99 million for a 9,200 square foot building. 3.1 of that would be new construction, $865,500 would be renovation of the existing building out there, which would be CPA eligible. $646,600 would be for site development costs, which our understanding is CPA eligible as well. And then
the $364,600 would be the build-out for the upper level there. And with having Blackstone Valley do that, we'd save about $200,000 of that. The rest would go towards materials for the build-out. Morrison Drive would be in the range of 3.6 to 3.85 million for a 6,700 square foot building. That's all new construction costs, and with the $300,000 of site development, which down there would not be CPA eligible. And the recommendation of the committee would be to renovate the former fire station, provide that $1 to $1.5 million of non-taxpayer impacted sources can be used to offset the cost, which would bring it in line with the Morrison Drive costs. And the rationale is that for about the same impact on the taxpayer, we can get a 9,200 square foot building on Town Hall campus, which is preferred over a 6,700 square foot building in the woods off of Morrison Drive, which would still have space issues for the police department. And then there's the timing for the debt for the MISCO and the NIPBUNK.
Great. So just on the cost comparison, going back to it, just so we're all clear, it looks like really the impact, you know, the total project is $4.99 million. However, roughly $1.4 million of that can be used from CPA
eligible.
Eligible. So the real impact, if you really think about it, is, or the comparison, shall I say, is a $3.1 million project for 9,200 square feet versus 3.6 to 3.8 for 6,700 square feet. I mean, to me, that's a no-brainer.
Kind of a no-brainer, absolutely.
It's a little more than 3.1. It's 3.1 plus the materials for the second fit out. So it's more. It's at least
3.3.
But still, your point is well taken.
Yeah. Quite a bit.
You're getting a much bigger bang for your buck with it.
And it gets us closer to the chief's needs. And the DPH requirements that are out there today for a town of our size.
And it also gives you expansion capabilities for the future.
Yeah, to me that's a no-brainer. Plus we get to repurpose a building that's been sitting there for years. Next door.
Yeah, 8 years. No
it's
use.
Sitting there for 8 years, no use. Yeah. So. Okay.
One of the biggest concerns I have of just not using Morrison Drive is simply the sweat equity and the financial donations that were poured into it. So I think it's going to be very important that we find a very good use and way to deal with the repurpose, use that space to honor those the commitment and the effort people put in to that building. Now, at some stage, we're going to need to do that. Okay, any further questions? Ms. Mazar.
What is the square footage that the police are using right now, just for comparison,
Don and I calculated that.
Yeah. What's that, the existing police station area?
Don and I actually went through each room and measured it and calculated it.
Will that include downstairs too?
Yep, that includes, so.
What's it, about 3,000 square feet?
I think it's a little more than that.
It's gonna be more than that.
Yeah, it's a little more than that. I want to say it's around 4,000, somewhere around there.
Let me see that.
I think that's an important number to point out that, you know, a town of our size is supposed to have how many square feet?
11,000.
They were close to 11,000, the architect.
What you're working with currently, I think that's.
Yeah. We actually calculated all the square footage.
Well, what the foundation size was that?
To have.
Or do you think it just double it?
No, because there's a lot of unusable space there. So there's a difference between gross and net.
Right? Yeah. What we did is we tried to get the actual net, you know. So we subtracted what you couldn't use, and like we didn't count the eaves up there. And
well, it's probably sufficient to answer the question that it's not north of 4,000, right?
It might be.
So if it's not north of 4,000, that makes your point, Mrs. Mazar, right? I mean, you just wanted to point out how far away from the recommendation it is. So I don't think it's important that you necessarily find the exact number, Don, but if you do find it at some point, let us know. In the meantime, any other questions? Okay.
I think the building committee did a fantastic job.
Yeah, I would have to say so as well. Yes, thank you very much.
Yeah, I would say that I mean, I was able to attend a lot of their meetings, and they were very thorough in the process and really followed through with what we asked them to do.
It was some good, healthy debate. Okay, good. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So do you want to make a motion and support the recommendation to move forward?
I will. I move to select the former fire station located at 24 Main Street to be renovated as the Mendon Police Station.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, thanks again, people. Thank you very much.
Yeah. We have one executive session, right?
So Joe, you're gonna go home and practice that pitch for the annual town meeting?
I will be in touch.
So who's it gonna fall to? Is it gonna fall to Don? Oh boy, okay. All right.
We'll do a fine job.
I think Peterson will do a great job.
Okay, so that concludes our official business. So now we need to move it. Yes?
I do have one thing I wanted to bring up.
Yes, please.
Which was...
Guys?
I had thought about, you know, potentially doing a couple of coffee hours.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that. I thought of that earlier, too. Yeah.
I wanted to see if there was any dates that would work. I know we can maybe come up with at least one, but you're going away.
Yeah, but I'll have the weekends on either side available, so I'm not leaving till Monday,
okay.
And then I'll be back late Friday. So if we're going to do, you know, kind of the Saturday like we've done in the past, I think I've got them all open from here till the town meeting. So
yeah, and I think maybe even one after town meeting.
That yeah, works. You're right. We should have,
do one
maybe one before and one after, something like that.
Right.
Okay, so do you want to look at our schedules and see if we pick those now, since we're all together?
Sure.
Okay, so...
The earlier, the better for me, guys, so if we
could... Earlier in the morning, you mean?
Yeah.
Are you planning on having informational meetings here about this specifically, or are you planning on possibly doing them with tours of the police station, or are you planning on the senior center? What is your...
I'd like to do the senior center again, because I think that's a great...
Are you planning on doing
that? And I think they come comfort of the missing...
Because I just would need to obviously check on availability of that location. Obviously, we know this would be available if that's not available, but we'll check there
first.
Well,
let's fix the date, and if we run into a situation where we have to change the venue...
4127.
Yep.
Okay, so let's see. So the
Going back to the time in the morning, I'm free every weekend. Obviously, the 29th doesn't work because that's Memorial Day weekend. But I'm sorry, not
29th
Memorial
Day.
No. I'm thinking. I'm going way ahead. I'm sorry.
You're going way ahead.
Yeah. Beyond the vote. I was in the wrong. We're not going to do it.
You know what's funny is I just clicked on that date and I looked down real quick. Sorry.
No, I'd like to propose we do the 29th.
Oh, that works for me.
Why not? Yeah, 9 o'clock?
If we could do 8:30, that'd be great for me, too.
8:30 is fine. I mean, I don't think that's too early for field, do you think?
No. Because they can show up at, you know, we can do a block of time.
Do you think that would impact resident attendance if we make it 8:30?
In the morning?
Yeah. I feel like I've had comments about timing on those. Yeah. I don't remember.
You think it would be a little later, you mean?
I mean, we could do one earlier and another one at a little later time.
I'd be totally fine with that.
Give people
8:30 and 1:30. I'd be okay with that. And if you can't make it, Chris, you can't. We'll just.
That's fine. That's
is
fine.
That okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
Are you going to be discussing other things besides the police station, or is it a general ATM discussion, or is it just police station? Just so for agenda purposes.
Well, I think it's awfully hard to tell people if they come to meet and greet you that if they want to ask a question.
So you just
want to
do
else.
Meet and greet.
That's what we did.
Exactly. With the primary topic being Q&A on the police station, but clearly they can come with any question that they have.
Just want to make sure we are being...
Okay, so if we take the 29th then, 8:30 and 1:30,
And then let's, like you said, Mark, maybe one right, one after, in between the vote and the town meeting. So town meeting's the 5th, right? So what if we went the 13th, the same exact thing on the 13th?
Doing 8:30 on the 29th?
And that's the 350th cake cutting ceremony, too.
What time is that?
2:00.
And that's going to be at the Unitarian, is that right?
That's what I have here. This says...
Boy, that was quick.
Clough Elementary School.
Chris, is that far, that far ahead if we did a little later in the morning and just had one meeting? Is that okay with you? That far
Yeah. I can adjust my plans.
So what if we did 10 o'clock that day?
That's fine. I can just adjust my plans.
How about that, Mark? Is that okay?
Yep, that's fine.
So 10 o'clock on the 13th, then we don't bump into the cake cutting.
Where are we having it?
Again, Senior Center, I think.
Yep.
Okay. Is it also 1:30 on the 13th? Is it two
times? No, we're just saying 10 o'clock. Just one at 10 o'clock. Yep. All right, good. All right, thank you for bringing that up, Mike. I was thinking of that earlier myself, and I had forgotten it.
Yeah, I think that's important.
Yeah, absolutely.
Two things. So Don pulled it up. Our calculations came up to 4147, but that doesn't also account for, we have two ATVs down at the fire station, so we actually have taken up some of their space, too. So not only have we...
Does that include the space in this?
That's this building, that building, but we didn't include the fire station. Not this fire station. Mm-hmm. We've actually started to... take some of that fire station.
Oh, the existing fire station.
So what would be helpful is to split those square footages out.
Yeah, it's not a whole lot that we have there. I mean, we're taking two ATVs, so maybe a 10 by 10 area, add another 100 square feet to it.
So it would be good to know what's downstairs here and what's...
Yep. Yeah, we does have that, and then we also have, obviously, he put in here... is this on the website? So Don did a great job with this. He broke everything out. We put explanations in here, comments in here.
Yeah, we have it broken out by what's in town hall, what the different rooms and everything. So we have everything by actual functional use. How much is cell blocks, how much is dispatch, how much is communication. So I can provide this to you. Yeah. And it also lists all the things we don't have today that the new building will have.
So
it's about
so
10 items or 12 items that...
What I'd really like to see us do is I know you got this... Some of this stuff is posted and stuff on the website, but I would like people to be able to get to it from the homepage.
I already sent that to Dan.
You did?
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, good.
And then, so the second thing I wanted to bring up is, if you don't have any objections, I kind of want to do something down at the police station, too. I know I've talked to probably all three about this. Maybe off hours from what you're doing, have open houses down there.
Absolutely.
Maybe every hour on the hour from noon to 4 on a Saturday. Groups can come down and I'll give them a tour through the whole station. We can walk across the town hall, show them town hall.
Yeah.
And then I even thought about if I can get it done in time, maybe do some type of informational video and see if we can put it on cable access. And that we could run once an hour or something. That shows the station conditions right now and maybe shows the presentation afterwards so they can see, you know, the information.
Sure. Yeah. Good.
So I'll go work on that tomorrow.
Okay.
All right.
Good.
Great.
Thank you. All right, we ready for executive session? Okay, so I move to enter into executive session under Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A2, to conduct a strategy session in preparation for contract negotiations with non-union personnel for town administrator. We will adjourn from executive session. Adjourn from executive session. That should say we'll adjourn, reconvene only to adjourn. A roll call vote is needed.
Second.
All those in favor?
Burke, aye.
Real aye.
Schofield, aye. Good night. Thank you. Thank you.